Good evening. I'm Chris Fox, Skinner Auctions Director of Historic Arms and Militaria. And this evening, we're going to do a virtual gallery walk, talking about some of the great highlights coming up in our Historic Arms and Militaria auction happening a live sale this Friday, beginning at 10 a.m., and a timed online auction that is already open for bidding and begins closing at 7 p.m. on October 28th, this coming Thursday. So I'm standing in this area here, surrounded by some really great 18th century weaponry, swords behind me, there's muskets on the table in front of me. So let's jump into it. The live sale features about 50 swords spanning the late 17th through the 17th century through the American Revolution period. We have swords that were used by British forces, American forces, French, as well as a few German swords. It's a nice representative selection, if you will, of many of the types of edge weapons that were commonly being used during that period. I should add up front that most of the material in the live sale, all of the early material, in fact, or virtually all of the early material, comes from one collector, a gentleman named William Rose, who collected very aggressively for 20 to 30 years. Collected really fine examples of 18th century and colonial period muskets and swords, pistols and so on, trying to build a collection that was representative of the sorts of arms that were used or may have been used in America during the colonial period. Within his collection of swords, there's some really, really iconic examples. Many folks watching may recognize this as a basket-hilted broadsword. And it's a double-edged sword, three narrow fullers near the top of the blade, and a very elaborate basket hilt on it. This particular sword would date to about the mid-18th century, and this is the sort of thing that a Scottish officer likely would have been carrying as he was serving in the military. During the French and Indian War in America, of course, one of the most famous Scottish regiments was the 42nd Regiment of Foot. And while we don't know who owned this sword in the 18th century, it is a sword that a Highland officer, perhaps in that unit, may have carried. In addition to elaborate officer swords, we have swords that are very basic in comparison, including weapons such as this. Very simple iron-hilted sword has sort of a, what some people refer to as sort of a figure eight hilt type. You can see the way it's shaped here. This is a type of sword that was made about the mid-18th century, maybe third quarter of the 18th century, and it's a British naval cutlass. It's a sword that was basically just a business weapon. It was made for fighting. What's particularly interesting about these swords with respect to America in the 18th century is that we know from documentary evidence that a large number of these very simple iron-hilted naval cutlasses were actually sent to America by the 1740s, 1750s period. And although it was originally made for naval use, records pretty strongly indicate that a lot of these swords actually got used by land troops as a secondary weapon for militia forces, for example, here in New England, as well as in the South. So it's not a particularly rare sword as 18th century swords go, but at the same time, it really is an iconic type of sword that if you're collecting the type of etched weapons used in America during the mid-18th century, this is one of those must-haves. This is another British naval cutlass, but this is about a generation earlier, made in the early 18th century. And you can see that it has this sort of an earlier version of this sort of double disc or figure eight type hilt to it. But in the case of this sword, it's a bit more elaborate. Rather than just having a cylindrical iron grip on it, it has a staghorn grip on it. It's got a nice gentle curve to it. And the guard on the sword has a nice scallop decoration. So it's got a bit more of a decorative element to it. But by the mid-18th century, the sword that we just looked at, that had gone by the wayside. It's just pure function. if you were an officer serving, say, in, well, if you were an officer, say, serving in the British Army, in the Revolution, you may have used a sword or carried a sword something like this. This is a silver-hilted spadroon, it's called. It has an open work hilt on it, a nice scroll decoration on the counter guard, wire wrap grip, and a very prettily decorated knuckle bow and pommel to it. It also has a much narrower blade. It's a relatively light sword, and it's the sort of thing that would be very comfortable to carry around on your side as an officer. Certainly usable should the need arise in battle, but something like this really serves more of a decorative purpose, or a purpose that is part of an officer's overall appearance, if you will. Swords are not just meant for military use. There are plenty of swords that were made for the civilian market as well. And this is just a very pretty example of a silver-hilted small sword. The swords that we were looking at had either wide curved blades, or maybe it had a straight blade that was fairly wide. This one has a straight blade, but in cross sections, very triangular, which makes it a very rigid blade. Some of the blades you're just looking at were more for cutting, if you will, or slashing, whereas a blade of this type is meant for jabbing, kind of like a fencing sword. But unlike the other swords, it has a very delicate hilt to it. It's silver, has a very finely wrapped wire grip on it, and is very light. And it's the sort of thing that a fashionable gentleman may wear as he's out and about in town, for example. I doubt that many of these swords ever saw real use, but it's really one of those sort of iconic types of swords that, if you're familiar with 18th century portraiture of gentlemen, particularly in English scenes or settings, you'll very often see them wearing a small sword on a belt around their waist.
So Chris, we've got a request to hear some lot numbers along with it.
Certainly. The basket hilt broadsword, in fact, is lot number 7, early in the sale. Most of these swords that I've been just speaking of, in fact, are in the first part of the sale. The naval cutlasses being lots number 10 and 11. This English spadroon, lot 17. And the small sword that I just spoke about is lot number 16. Let's talk about a couple of muskets. In this sale, there are 15 or 17 really interesting examples of Revolutionary War period, slightly earlier muskets. This particular example, which is lot number 22 in the sale, is one of my favorites. It's a patterned 1769 short land service musket. It's a British made musket. In fact, this one was made at Dublin Castle in Ireland and was issued, as we can tell by markings on the brass plate on the wrist here, to the 34th Regiment of Foot. Now, the 34th Regiment received an allotment of arms in February of 1776 before departing for North America. On the brass plate, the thumb piece here, is engraved 34 over D over number 33. And that's very significant in really understanding the history of this gun, 34 being the 34th Regiment of Foot. The D stands for Company D, or the fourth company in that regiment. And in the case of the 34th, that fourth company belonged to the Grenadier Company. Grenadiers were typically more elite troops. They were part of the flanking companies, if you will. They sort of would be in the advance of troops as they're on the march. And then the 33 is simply gun number 33 within that company. Now, the 34th Regiment, upon arriving in America, went to Quebec, and they joined an army that was being formed by General John Burgoyne. In the spring of 1777, General Burgoyne launched an invasion into New York from Canada, coming down the Champlain Valley, past Crown Point, through Ticonderoga, down Lake George, and so on, before the Army ultimately ended up at Saratoga, where, if you remember our history, was forced to surrender to the American forces in October. We know from documentary records that two companies of the 34th Regiment, in fact, were with General Burgoyne's Army. One of those companies, in fact, being the Grenadier Company, the other one being the Light Company. And so we don't know the identity of the soldier who originally carried this musket, but it is the type of musket that was being used by the Grenadier Company of 34th at that time. So there's a very good possibility that this was at Saratoga in 1777, thus being a very historic musket. Let's move on down a little bit. There's a couple of other interesting muskets I'd like to share with you as we move along here. So what I have here is a French musket. This is known as the Model 1763/66 infantry musket. Documentary records, particularly here in New England, show thousands upon thousands upon thousands of these types of muskets coming into Portsmouth, coming into the Boston region, beginning in 1776. One of the shipments that came into Boston had about 2,000 guns sort of waylaid, if you will, into New Hampshire. And those muskets are very distinctive in that not long after they went to New Hampshire, a silversmith by the name of John Ward Gilman was hired to mark guns on the barrel to identify which New Hampshire battalion the gun was to be issued to. And this is one of those example of one of those guns. Now, these New Hampshire marked muskets are not terribly rare as Revolutionary War guns go. There are quite a few that do survive, but what's special about them is that they're marked New Hampshire. This one's marked to the 2nd Battalion, specifically gun number 472. So these New Hampshire marked muskets are among the very, very few guns that are marked to a specific regiment from the period of the American Revolution. And that's what makes them really exciting to collectors. This is a nice, fairly clean example. Good looking stock with some little bit of staining. The metal was cleaned a long time ago, but it still has a fairly pleasant look to it, I would say. This is, for those interested, this is lot number 50 in the auction, and I expect this to do quite well. Another type of French musket that was coming into America at the same time as the one we just discussed is this, which on the surface looks virtually identical to the gun that we just looked at. But while the one I just talked about is described as the Model 1763/66, this is a true 1763. Now we're kind of splitting hairs here about the details, but these are the sorts of things that are important to collectors, because a true 1763 musket is a pretty rare gun. I think in the years that I've been working with 18th century firearms, which is going close to 30 years now, I've only probably personally held 5 or 6 examples of these. And one of the principal differences here, and again, it's a minor thing, but the 1763 model has a iron cover along the upper portion of the ramrod channel. What does it do? It helps keep the rammer in place as you're returning it. And I think it was found to be really unnecessary and an added expense to a gun that was otherwise perfectly functional. And they did away with it very quickly. But, you know, so finding an example with the true 1763 with that rammer channel guide still in place is a pretty unusual thing. So again, I think this will be a fairly popular musket with folks on Friday. This is lot number 51. We have a couple of blunderbusses in the auction. Blunderbusses are these short-barreled arms of a very wide flaring muzzle. Lots of times you'll see them in pirate movies or whatnot. reality with the historical reality with these types of guns, though, is that they were really designed for use on coaches as a sort of close quarters defensive weapon. But they did also see a fair amount of service on ships. This particular gun was likely made in England in the early 18th century. It's very simple, brass furniture, a long, narrow extension on the butt plate, very pretty scroll sight plate on it, and a fairly simple iron barrel. This is lot number 27. Let's move a little bit further down the table here. And I want to talk about a couple of American muskets. Now, in America, there was some level of arms making or assembling, perhaps is more to the point, really by at least the mid-17th century. So fairly early on in America's history, there were guns that were being assembled from damaged guns or parts that were starting to come over. And a lot of those early guns that were being assembled were really meant for hunting. They were fowling guns. And one of my favorite arms in this collection is this really long gun. It's a fowler made for hunting waterfowl, but it's a really early example of a New England made fowler. It's really, I think, a lot of fun to think that this gun may have been made within an hour of where I'm standing right now. It's fairly simple. In fact, does not, nor did it ever have a butt plate on it, which is a trait that you often see on early guns. There's no side plate at all. And the trigger guard is just simply an iron, just a simple iron band of metal that's attached to the stock with several rosette nails. And that's the way it was built. The barrel on this is a fairly long, narrow barrel that has this very prominent sight near the breech. It's a type of barrel that you commonly would see on a matchlock musket from sort of the first half of the 17th century. And then it has an early style flintlock mechanism on it. So, you know, if this gun were built around 1700, more or less, it was using some parts that were at least a generation, if not more, old. But again, when we're talking about some of the arms production in America at that time, they're building guns out of materials that they had on hand in many cases. Unlike the few guns that we just looked at, the stock on this gun goes just about to the muzzle, which is an indicator that this wasn't built for military purpose. It was built for hunting. If it were built for a military purpose, like the guns we had just looked at, we'd have several inches of muzzle extending beyond the stock, and then a rectangular lug mounted either on the top or the bottom so that you could mount a bayonet on it. Now, what's really interesting when we sort of fast forward to the period of the American Revolution, because there still wasn't a great deal of military arms production happening in America at that time. As war was approaching, as war was just breaking out, the Massachusetts Board of War, for example, had lots of parts of guns. They had lots of damaged guns that they quickly sent out to gunsmiths surrounding Boston, as far west as at least, Leominster, Sutton, and so on. And they were having gun makers assemble these parts into guns that could be used for military service. At the same time, they were taking hunting muskets or fowlers, and they were trimming back those stocks by about 4 inches or so and adding bayonet lugs to them so they could actually mount a bayonet to make them usable for military service. This musket here, which is lot number 98, is a nice example of a musket that is built of foreign parts. In this case, parts from a French musket from the first half of the 18th century, probably of the 1728, 1754 type models. And it's exactly the sort of thing that was being produced by gun makers at the beginning of the revolution using old parts. And in the case of this gun, with this nice, gentle, just subtle sort of downward sweep in the butt here, it's a trait that's fairly common to New England. And again, unfortunately, we don't know specifically who owned this gun in the 18th century, but judging by the overall style of it, the sweep on the butt, it's very possible that this is another example of a musket that was made not far from where we're standing right now and very easily could have played an important role at the beginning of the American Revolution here in Boston. And there are several other examples of these American-made sort of beginning of the revolution type muskets in this collection. Some have similarities with British muskets, like that short land cutter that we looked at first off. It has a butt plate very similar. It has a trigger guard that, even though this is an American-made trigger guard, it's mimicking the British-style trigger guard of that period, but uses a French lock. So you see a lot of interesting variations in these early war period muskets. And I think that historically, when I look back at arms collecting over the last 20 or 30 years, these types of American-made muskets have, I would argue, been by and large overlooked by people seeking really the classic British muskets or the classic French muskets. Whereas, you know, these guns are just as important, arguably for the American cause more important, because they're reflective of a period when the American Army is just getting formed. They're doing everything they can to get arms into the system so that they can move forward with this revolution to break away from Britain once and for all. While we're in the area, I've got another table of swords. There's a couple of interesting ones that are certainly worth mentioning. Another one of my favorites is this saber that has sort of a dog's pommel on it, and then these couple of decorative branches coming off of the knuckle bow and a simple open work counter guard on here. This is number 69 in the sale. A number of swords virtually identical to this have been found over the years in the New Hampshire area. So it's a type of sword that collectors are largely associating with New Hampshire manufacture. We don't specifically know who made them. Based on the overall style, it's probably from around the beginning or so of the American Revolution, but they're not marked, so there's not a whole lot more we can necessarily say about them. There are a number of examples that have turned up that are virtually identical to this. In fact, a few years ago, Skinner sold a similar example, same type of hilt, but instead of having, and it also had a very plain grip on it, this one has a cherry grip. The one that we sold a few years ago had an oak grip. So, but exactly the same otherwise. And let's not forget that sort of like musket production in the 18th century in America, where there weren't a lot of really well established manufactories, the same is true for swords. And this interesting thing here is sort of a conglomeration of a couple of different swords here. The brass small sword type hilt on it is actually French, probably from the first half or mid 18th century. But the blade that it's on is probably of English, European manufacture. It's actually marked 1745 and has a very crude sort of chiseled in running fox motif. Sort of generic motif that you see on a lot of swords made in England as well as Europe. Anyhow, sword parts from two different sources that came together to create something that was serviceable, almost certainly for a militia officer. And again, I think it's a type of sword that they're around, they survive. I see them at shows, I see them at auctions, but a lot of times they tend to get overlooked because they're not the pure sword. But at the same time, it is a uniquely American piece that has at least a really interesting unspoken history behind it. And
what was the lot number, Chris, for that?
That was lot number 71. And while in America at the same time that those iron-hilted British naval cutlasses were being used, there was a little bit of production of other naval cutlasses here as well. And this, I think, is a pretty interesting example of one of those. Very simple, curved, single-edged blade on it. It has a mark SS, which is the bladesmith's mark. No idea who it is at this point. Maybe in time we'll discover that with research. Simple, sort of half of a heart-shaped type counter guard with it. But what I particularly like about this sword is that on the top surface of the guard, as well as the bottom surface of the guard. And if you go onto the website, look at the catalog listing, you can see a close-up of this. What you'll find is that there is a really pretty and simple sort of scrolling vine and flower decoration on it. And it's a decoration that reminds me very much so of the crewel work embroidery that you would see on bed hangings from sort of the first half of the 18th century, the mid-18th century as well. We also see some of that type of decoration on powder horns. So it's the sort of thing that makes me wonder, you know, who exactly was the person that made this? Where were they? Were they really thinking of this crewel work when they did that decoration on there? We may really never know, but I think it's a very interesting decoration that, at least in my mind, really points to an American origin. And again, that is lot number 77 in the auction. There was some production of or manufacture of much finer swords also happening in America. A silver hilted small sword that is completely unmarked, which is unusual for English made or European made, but it has traits about it that really point to an American origin. You know, the grip on here being so narrow and relatively long in relation to it's a tall hilt, this sort of a little oddly shaped pommel, but yet has this very narrow waist below the top of it. They're traits that we see on other American swords that are marked. And because it's not marked, I really can't give an indication of who made it or even where it was made specifically in the colonies, but I am pretty confident that it is an American-made sword. And it's a very pretty example of a sword that, again, was made for either more of a civilian-type use, or it may have also been used by an officer in a militia or perhaps in a provincial unit, the French and Indian War. Again, this is lot number 79. The collection also features a fairly good number of military pistols, probably about 25 or so, that mostly date from the late 17th century through the period of the American Revolution. The collector was particularly keen on these earlier, longer barreled cavalry pistols. Most of the pistols that we have in the sale, in fact, were used by cavalry troops. We have some that were used by naval or sea service troops, as well as a few pistols that were made for civilian use, a couple of which may have been, in fact, used by officers. But these longer barrel pistols, typically used by cavalry troops, they have a sort of a long sweeping grip to them. Sometimes they have iron mounts such as this, or they can have brass. Oftentimes the mounts are fairly plain. This has some nice engraving on it. This is an English or potentially Dutch made pistol, but likely used by English forces. And it's a good representation of these long barrel pistols that we know after they were considered more or less obsolete in Europe or in England, did make their way to America and ended up in the hands of some of the American militia cavalry troops of the mid-18th century, or even to some extent used by some forces perhaps in the revolution. But any of these early long barrel pistols tend to be fairly scarce. There aren't a great number of them that survive, and it's really a treat to have been able to work with such a large and diverse collection of these pistols that are actually, they're pretty exciting. You have some British examples, some French examples, some Dutch, and even a couple of likely American examples as well. So this particular one is lot number 31, and there are several in succession. And then if you look further into sale, you see more French pistols and some American as well. But military is not all about guns and swords. We have powder horns in the auction as well. This is a nice example of a Siege of Boston period powder horn. This one belonged to a man named Frederick Bigelow. That's the name that's carved on there, dated June 1775 at Roxbury Camp. Roxbury was an American camp to the southwest of Boston, part of a ring of fortifications that surrounded the town to keep the British sort of held up in town as the American army was forming around it. It belonged to, so Frederick Bigelow actually served in the 8th Company of the 2nd Regiment, 2nd Connecticut Regiment in 1775. Powder horns, I've always felt, are sort of more personal objects. They usually have names on them that you can connect to specific people. If you do research into the regimental histories within the muster rolls, you can learn something about these people. Most guns don't have that. But, you know, here we have a name associated with an object, and through his name, we can track what he did, in this case, during the American Revolution. There are also some more decorative, rank-related items, such as these two pieces. These are officers' gorgettes. It's really the last vestige of medieval armor, purely ceremonial, purely decorative by the time that these are being used. And they would be suspended from a cord around an officer's neck, worn about right here, simply as an indication of his status as an officer in the army. British gorgettes, such as this one, are made of gilded sheet copper, and it has a very finely engraved English coat of arms on it. This is lot number 2 in the auction. And then this one, which is a very rare piece, lot number 1, is an example of a French officer's gorget from about the mid, say, third quarter of the 18th century. It's made of cast brass with a gilded surface, and then it has this royal device on there that is essentially a silvered stamped copper emblem that is attached to the face of it with a couple of little sort of like cotter pin like attachments. I have to admit that is my years of as a museum curator with this type of material and working with it. That's the first example of a real 18th century French officer's gorget, at least that I've been able to handle. So it's exciting to me. As I said, it's more about military is about more than guns and swords. We have some documents in the sale as well, including a really neat example of a 1760 Massachusetts provincial enlistment form filled out to a man named Nathan Tyler of Rowley, Massachusetts, lot number 140. And then we have this, which I think is one of the most special pieces in the sale. The enlistment papers was lot number 140. This document here, this piece, is lot number 141. This is a 1775 issue of the Nathaniel Lowe Almanac. He published almanacs in Boston. When we open it, as I have here, to the April-May page spread within this, the original owner wrote an inscription in the margin here that speaks to the events of Lexington and Concord in April of 1775. He writes, "On the 19th of April, 1775, a fight began with the regulars at Lexington They burnt the courthouse in Concord and killed a number of our people in Lexington and Cambridge and thereabout. Items, whether they're documents, objects, firearms, what have you, that are connected to the events of April 19, 1775, have always been particularly highly sought after by collectors. They're, it's the beginning of the revolution. It's really literally day one. And while it's a very simple inscription within this, it's remarkable to me that the person who wrote it knew well enough at that time that what was happening that day was going to change things in America forever. And he made a record of it. And that's pretty exciting to me. So most of the live sale on Friday focuses on this collection, this wonderful collection of early Militaria. But the last few lots in the sale we have from a few other collectors, from a few other sources. And I just want to touch on a couple of really interesting pieces. One of which is this really unusual pistol here. It's an Elgin patent cutlass pistol. It was made in 1837. The US Navy contracted for 150 of these firearms that sport this heavy buoy type blade mounted to the bottom of the barrel here. And from historical records, we know that these cutlass pistols were actually used. They were taken on an expedition to explore areas of the South Pacific in the late 1830s into the early 1840s. And when you read excerpts of that expedition, you actually do find a few instances where they talk about actually having used these pistols in some of their engagements. When the pistol was originally made or issued, it included a nickel, silver, and leather holster scabbard. There are, from what I understand, there are around 20 or so examples of these pistols that are known to survive. Of those 20 or so that survive, it's my understanding that there are maybe three or four that actually have the original holster scabbards. And you know, we're fortunate enough with this one to have its original holster scabbard. Now, it is missing the tip of it, and it is, you know, a little worse for wear, but it survives. It's much rarer than the pistol, and it's a pretty exciting thing to be able to have that with the pistol. And I think that the successful bidder is likely going to be very pleased to add this to his or her collection. It's lot number 187. Finally, I can't end the discussion in the live sale without talking about this. Now, why would we have a late 20th century Colt Python revolver in a sale that otherwise focuses on early material? Well, this has a pretty interesting history. We have a letter from the Colt Archives that documents that this pistol was delivered in March of 1974 to a man named Charles Ruchon. Charles Ruchon was one of the most important military liaisons and technical advisors to the James Bond films of the 1960s and early 70s. He's known to have worked on at least five films, and he, Ruchon, was the person responsible for making the scene in Thunderball when James Bond escapes with that jetpack at the beginning of the film. He arranged for that jetpack to be used in the film. In the film Goldfinger, Ruchon, using his extensive connections within the United States government, was able to secure the permission from several government agencies to allow filming to actually take place on the Fort Knox military base in Kentucky. And he did similarly important things in the film From Russia with Love and Diamonds Are Forever and Live and Let Die. It's fair to say that without Ruchon's influence with those early films, some of the most iconic scenes that, if you're a Bond film, like I am, you can't help but love. So what's the connection with this gun besides Ruchon? Charles Ruchon died in 1982. The consigner of the revolver was very good friends with Ruchon. And in 1982, after he died, the consigner was asked by Krishan's wife to help disperse a large collection of firearms that he'd amassed over his career. So he did, he helped out. And the wife said, in gratitude for his help, said, if you're interested in one of his firearms, just pick one, you can have it. It's a token of thanks. So he picked a python, not knowing anything about the gun's history. As soon as he selected the revolver, the wife said, oh, Charlie told me that he got that one specifically for the man with the golden gun. It's obviously not the golden gun. And that's a very different type of made up pistol that was used in the film. But the fact is, if you watch the film carefully, The Man with the Golden Gun, there is a scene in the movie where you can see a Colt python. It's a 6-inch barrel python. It's very brief. It's very darkly lit. And frankly, you can't see the whole gun. But there's no question that it is a python. Now, I can't say that this gun and the one that you see in the film, in fact, are the same revolvers. But what we do know, without question, is that it did belong to Charles Ruchon, who's incredibly important in the history of the Bond films, and that at least his wife indicated that he had acquired that gun for that movie specifically. So take it for what it's worth. It's an interesting thing, and at least as a connection to somebody heavily involved with the Bond films, the classic Bond films of the 60s and 70s, I think it's pretty cool. So we've got this great live sale. We also have a timed online sale that is open for bidding currently. The Python is lot number 190, the last lot in the sale. Can't forget that. The timed online auction is currently open for bidding, remains open through Thursday evening when it begins the closing process at 7 p.m. And it includes a wide selection of Militaria, including guns and swords, a lot of documents, some small artillery helmets spanning World War I, World War II, Civil War, Spanish-American War. We have a nice selection of World War I long arms and handguns, American, a little bit of British, German. The same is true for the World War II era. Plenty of sporting guns that are from the second half of the 20th century, target rifles, target pistols, and so on. Lots of material in original boxes, in fact. So it's a very, it's a good solid sale. There's lots more I could talk about in the live sale, let alone the online sale, but check it all out on our website, www.skinnerinc.com. You'll see under our auctions page, a link for the timed online auction, and then just below that, a link for the live sale. Thank you for joining me tonight, talking about some of the really cool things that we have coming up in the next several days here. And
do you want to take any questions?
Absolutely. If there are some questions, I'd be happy to do the best I can to address those.
Sure. While we're waiting for questions to come in, I'd like to talk a little bit more about the collector, William Rose, and how that...
So Bill Rose, he's a collector who's had a retired naval officer. He had a lifelong interest in military history, particularly connected with the American Revolution and colonial wars. His collecting attempted to bring together the body, representative body of material that may have been used, was used, or may have been used by troops in America. Like any good collector, over time, as his knowledge base grew, as his contacts grew, he was able to do some upgrading. You know, we all as collectors, we all start out sort of collecting anything that we can, but as we learn more, as we're able to acquire better things, it's not uncommon for us to, you know, move along some of those old early purchases. So as time went by, Bill worked very hard, very diligently to upgrade his collection. And it really shows when you look at this material in detail. Every collection of this type is going to have some restoration here and there. It just comes with this type of collecting, but by and large, the collection is pretty solid. It's really been a treat working with it. And, you know, I've I've said to many people over the years that there's hardly a day that goes by here that I don't learn something. And even though I've been specifically working with this 18th century material for close to 30 years now, I learned plenty of great things. I mean, handling the material, looking at it, you always learn more. Maybe there's marks that you didn't notice. You're noticing something about the way the parts were assembled or whatever. There's just endless ways you can continue to learn.
The question about open previews process.
So we're doing active previewing for the sale throughout this week through Thursday. We ask that you just contact us ahead of time so that we can know when you're coming, sort of an appointment basis. What we're trying to avoid with COVID still among us is having a situation where we're overcrowded in the area where we're previewing, but we've been managing that very well. So if you have any interest about coming in to do any preview for these sales, by all means, send me an email at militaria@skinnerinc.com and I'll be glad to accommodate you. Well, thank you again. This has been a lot of fun to share this great material with you. For those of you that plan to come preview it, I look forward to seeing you in the next few days here. For any of you who may be planning to bid on this, any of these items, if you have any questions at all, you want some additional photographs or something more specific about condition, reach out to me at militaria@skinnerinc.com. And above all, good luck in your bidding.
Thank you, Chris.